everyone. This is Defense Politics Asia, and this is the summary for the day of 616 to 617 for the 1st to 2nd of November. I actually missed out one report in the previous SIP, right? Well, there was a surface drone strike at Sevastopol, and I think three unmanned, I think suicide boats tried to enter the port. Two was destroyed, and one managed to run away. That's quite interesting that they actually run away. So anyway, other than that, there was a lot of those drone strikes, aerial drones and missiles. But yeah, but most of them didn't really do much, so nothing worth reporting. In the southern front, the main battle in this front in the Kherson region is mainly at this Kryenki region. So this is Kryenki. Kryenki is actually in you can see that Kherson is here, this Kherson, and this is Novokakhovka, and now Kryenki is over here. And the Ukrainian forces continue to manage to hold this beachhead, and they are under severe pressure from the Russian forces over the past 2 days. And geolocation suggests that the Ukrainian forces are still within Kryenki, and the Russian forces are trying to attack through the forest region. However, this geolocation is actually a scene of dead Russian soldiers. And the Russians, I think, if I'm not wrong, they sent in the Marines. So according to the corps of Russian Marines, yeah. So they are from the Caspian Flotilla. So these are considered more of the elite troops, a bit like the airborne troops. So it shows the importance of this town, the need to clear out the Ukrainian forces over at this beachhead. So they sent in the more advanced troops. So far, the Ukrainian forces are making a very good effort to hold a position, and that's all from the southern front. We'll move on over at the Zaporizhia front. So this is the Zaporizhia front line, and we have the Orykhiv sector and the Velika Novosilka sector. At the Orykhiv sector, just on the west of the Orykhiv sector, there is a geolocation south of Malyshubaki. So it's just some update in terms of the front line. So nothing very significant in that sense. Over at the Orykhiv sector, the Russian forces continue their counter-offensive over at this region here against the Ukrainian counter-offensive. So in a way, you can call this the counter-offensive. And so fighting is reported over the past 2 days at Robotyne over at Verbove. And Verbove only on the 1st of November. On the 2nd of November, I didn't see any information of any reports of fighting over here. The Ukrainian forces were pushing out towards the west of Robotyne over on the 1st. Also, we did not see a report of them fighting on the 2nd. So which means the Ukrainian offensive over in this region is also running pretty much near its course. And there's an important note is that the Ukrainian Defense Ministry's morning report, in today's morning report, they dropped the word assault in the Bakhmut front. So they say that they are doing offensive operations towards Melitopol, and then there is an offensive operation at Bakhmut front, then they bracket assault. This entire Bakhmut one disappeared. So it is a quiet acknowledgement that the Bakhmut offensive has basically ended. This is something I just want to note before I forget. There is some certain geolocation of Ukrainian forces over on the western part of Robotyne, which clearly shows there is fighting in this region here. Usually the geolocations so near the front line tend to suggest fighting. There is a geolocation over here on the 1st by Krimi Kapris. This is actually infantry units get attacked by Russian drones. They're holding the line over in the forest line around this region here, and then they got struck by Russian drones. So situation over here is getting more and more boring. I mean, for Ukraine war fans, that you know, you guys are evil people who want to watch this like a sports, yeah, it's getting a bit more boring, you know. Yeah, so that's what it is now. Moving on from the Orkiv sector, we go into the Huayipole sector. This is Huayipole, and at the Huayipole sector, we have some Russian offensive or assault operation seems to be developing over in the Novostratopol and over at Melnivka. So this name is very sexy. You know, it's like a slut. You know, slut. There's a slut over there, and Novo is new, so this is a new slut, Topil. So the new slut and a Melnivka, currently there is some kind of operation. The Melnivka one, the previous one was on the 22nd of October, which I did mention. It was interesting to have something over here, and then we have actually a new information on the 1st and the 2nd. There is fighting reported in this direction. It's reported by the Vostok Group of Forces, the Russian site actually reported about this. They are attacking Ukrainian forces that were doing rotations, and the Novostratopol one is only on the 1st of November. The 2nd November did not mention Novostratopol. So as you can see, only Melnivka, and there's no Novostratopol. So this is interesting. We will continue to watch if this will turn out to be a new offensive operation. Then it will be yet another big headache for the Ukrainian forces. We move on into the Velika Novosilka sector. This Velika Novosilka, this is the Velika Novosilka sector. Similarly, at this front line, you can see that the Russians are actually on the offensive over at the Rif sorry, Prigone, in the north of Prigone, at Staromayorsky, as well as Uruzhyne. And the actual location of Russian forces over this position corroborating that the front line is actually there. But this is not a good geolocation if you are pro-Russian. I think this one was attack of the infantry unit in the position of the Ukrainian forces, and then they were there's a mop up of an assault group of a stronghold of the Ukrainian forces with fire support. Okay, so it's not a negative one. So I remembered wrongly. I thought it's like some dead Russian soldiers or no under or Russian soldiers under attack. So there's a geolocation also over here for the Ukrainians in the southern part of Staromayorsky. But it just only shows that the Russians have not gone into an assault over at Staromayorsky. Despite we actually see information like no Ukrainian Defense Ministry say that the Russians conducted unsuccessful assault over in the area of Staromayorsky. However, if you look at the Russian information, they only say that they are actually trying to thwart rotation attempts. Similarly, on the next day, the same report is being repeated on the 1st and the 2nd of November. Uruzhyne, there is only an attack. Basically, this looks like a fire mission, according to the report coming from the Russian Defense Ministry for Uruzhyne. Prione region in the north is actually attacking rotations, and the one at northeast is, let me see, yeah, it's a fire mission. So the Russian forces is basically imposing themselves on the Ukrainians at this front line, and they are putting a lot of pressure. They are looking putting a lot of pressure on the Ukrainian forces, and the Ukrainian forces, you know, are struggling probably to do rotations to try to hold the position, because I don't think the Ukrainians have much left. I don't think they have much gas left in terms of offensive operation. The only thing they can do is to hold lines, and although the Ukrainians are very good at holding their lines, so let's see how this goes. We move on into the Donetsk front. So this is the Donetsk front. Just for history purposes, Donetsk front used to be really long, like you know, it used to be like this long. This is the entire of Donetsk front, but because we cut away this part as Sivers front, then we cut away this part as Bakhmut front, and then the New York front, ADFK front. So as a result, the Donetsk is only left with this part. So in case you guys are w wondering, because this entire state here, this entire oblast here, this is Donetsk. So which is why by right the whole front is actually Donetsk front. So anyway, over at this Donetsk front, we have reports of fighting near Preshetivka, according to the Ukrainian Defense Ministry on the 2nd, and Shevchenko on the 1st. Shevchenko is on the 1st, according to Deep State UA. Moving on to, we go to the Voleda, towards the east, towards the Voleda region. This is Voleda. This is a fortress city of Voleda, And at Voleda, there is fighting being reported near Voleda, according to Russian Defense Ministry. They are doing some fire missions on the Ukrainian forces over at Voleda, and there is reports of fighting near Mykolaiv. The Russian Defense Ministry Vostok Group of Forces reported that they are attacking the Ukrainian forces for doing rotations because they don't like people to turn, and then Deep State UA actually made a one-liner. They say that near Mykolaiv, massive columns of equipments they are mating, was stopped. So they don't like, the equipments to mate, because then they will duplicate and multiply, and that will give the Russian forces a lot more vehicles. So they say that these massive columns of vehicle equipments are stopped from effing each other. So that's it from Mykolaiv region. The Rush there is some reports that previously we have this fighting towards Vodine, or I just realized, this is not pronounced as Vodian, this is pronounced as Vodine. Yeah, the more you know, like after almost 2 years of reporting, then so Vodine, so all these reports of fighting towards or near Vodine is very suspicious. I want to see if the Russians actually push much higher. It's kind of unclear at this moment, but we shall see how this goes. Because this is actually a bit far to to just call it that. Anyway, over at Novomihailivka, we actually have fighting being reported over the past 2 days, according to the Russian Defense Ministry. And then the second one, the second day, the yesterday's one was corroborated by the Ukrainian Defense Ministry. Geolocation of Ukrainian forces on the south eastern part of Novomihailivka, showing that the Ukrainian forces' infantry was shelled by Russian artillery, but it does show that the Ukrainians are trying to hold the positions and protect this settlement. We move further up north, Marinka, we have Marinka Ting. Marinka Ting, is being always reported by the Ukrainian Defense Ministry. So, yeah, so if your life is being Marinka, you probably will get depression. So, we need to have progress in our life and not be Marinka. Further up, we into the Avdiivka front. This is Avdiivka front. It looks like over in the so there is actually some kind of like a double pincer or some one pincer, one very chunky pincer. So there is this direction. This the Russian forces are pushing in. Largely, it looks like this. And there is also other directions that is shown on the mapping of Rybar, the pro-Russian source, that is, however, not really being reported, which is actually did some push in this direction on the eastern part of Avdiivka. However, main thing, the main ones is actually still the jaws on the out on the outside, like baby shark do 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 do, and that kind of thing, and so the lower jaw of the baby shark, we have fighting reported at Prvomaiske on the 1st of November. I believe, yeah, I think this is first and second, probably. I believe it's first and second. Anyway, this reported by the Ukrainian Defense Ministry. Most of this information do come from the Ukrainian Defense Ministry, like the one at, oh no, Vodine. This is another Vodine or Vodiany. This is reported by Deep State UA and Rybar. They reported on the 1st, Tunenke by the Ukrainians on the 2nd, Sevene on the 1st and 2nd by the Ukrainian Defense Ministry, and Rybar also mentioned about it. Rybar also mentioned about fighting reportedly getting nearer and nearer to Khimik, or the Knife District. But this push in this direction continue to be vehemently rejected by Deep State UA, the pro-Ukrainian source. They say that this does not happen. This is not real. This is not a reality. So let's see. So far, Deep State UA usually have a better record than Rybar when come to accuracy, because Rybar do sometimes report stuff that end up did not happen. But not always, but sometimes. So let's see. There is this massive divide between the two major Osin of each side. Rybar, I believe, to me, is the biggest one, the most dependable one. And we have the Ukrainian side, we have the Deep State UA. I know there's another one called Military Maps, but the I think in term of plotting information, Rybar is easier for me. Military maps, of course, they have their own mapping. You might as well just use their mapping. So anyway, there is fighting reported at Opine over here by Deep State UA on the 1st of November. So the Russians are making putting pressure. Oh my God, my arrows are lousy. So they are putting pressure here. This time around, we did not have any reports of fighting in the southern part of Avdiivka, and further up in the northern flank, we have fighting reported near the Koplan. And then the Ukrainians were reportedly counter-attacking. Why? I think I forgot to change the date. I think this is 2nd of November. Yeah, I'm so sorry. Yes, sometimes when I do mapping, I get distracted. But the main 2 days is both actually by Deep State UA. They mentioned about the Russians. Main push is actually in this direction and not over in the Kimmich region, on the north of Opine. Further up north, we have fighting reported at Stepove by the Ukrainian Defense Ministry on the 2nd. And then there were some reports of, and there's some ch actually some frontline changes in this area here. The Russians have made some success north of Krasnohorivka and the northeastern part of Krasnohorivka. They are pushing out, and it's acknowledged by Deep State UA, and Rybar also reported about this. And yeah, you see, Deep State UA say that it's partial success. So if this is partial, I don't know why it's entirely successful. So yeah, no, this kind of standard is no very 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 hard to tell. No, you partial, like you have a bite of your food, and then I will say that you have a partial success in eating while you are still eating. So you only have partial success of eating. Like when you bathe halfway while you're soaping yourself, I'll say you have a partial success in bathing. So, and then anyway, there is a partial report. There is a advance towards the direction of Novokalinovye and Kalamykha, according to Rybar, on the 1st of November. So not very important, I would say. We shall see how this goes. And moving on from the Avdiivka front, we move into the New York front. This is New York. The Ukrainian Defense Ministry continued to insist that there is fighting over at the Pivdenia region, in this area here. We have not much intel other than the Ukrainian Defense Ministry simply making that one-liner. We shall wait and see if there's anything significant around this area here. Over at the Bakhmut front, in the southern part of Bakhmut front, as I mentioned in the previous SIP rep, the Russian forces basically have taken over the offensive with fighting at Kolyomivka, Andriivka, and Klishchievka. The Ukrainians were reported to have seemed to be attacking on the 2nd of November, according to the Russian Defense Ministry. But most of the fighting is just Russian. So Russian Defense Ministry, Ukrainian Defense Ministry, Deep State UA, basically everyone acknowledged that the Russians are actually on the offensive over in the Klishchievka region, and Andriivka similarly is reported by on the Ukrainian side, and Kolyomivka is reported by the Russians. So the entire Bakhmut front is fried. I would say no. Further up, just in the northeastern part of Bakhmut, fighting was reported at Kromove on the 1st of November. This Kromove. And there is fighting reported at Yakhine on the 2nd, as well as Berkivka. So the one at Yakhine and Berkivka is more tactical in nature. The one over here at Kromove, somehow the Ukrainians report describe it as Russians trying to restore lost position, which is very vague. No, partial success. So this is the current situation around this area here. There is geolocation of Ukrainian forces along the tree line around here, along the railway track. So this is geolocated by Crimea Caprice. So this is positional combat. So this is just artillery shelling on the Ukrainian forces. It's all from the Bakhmut front. We move into the Sivers. Sivers, we actually have no reports. Everything went very quiet, and we move into Krimina front. So this is Krimina. And at the criminal front, we have not much report around the PG front. We only have Ukrainians attacking reported on the 1st of November, according to the Russian Defense Ministry, as well as at Dibrova on the 2nd of November. As you can see, the tempo around here is getting slower and slower and slower. So, you know, don't eat so much because this is the piggy, right? The piggy eat so much, you know. So, the piggy front is sad. Okay, moving on, we move further up north. There is geolocation of Ukrainian forces over at Nevsky. They get airstrike by Russian fat bombs. Again, the usage of these guided unguided bombs getting more and more frequent, and is becoming as frequent from the from this very superficial outside view there, where we are just watching sources or videos and everything. These fat bombs are getting as frequent as the Lancers, as far as I can tell. So the Russians, basically their air force is flying unimpeded. There's a severe lack of surface to air missiles on the Ukrainian side right now. There is no air defense, there's no air to air fighters to intercept Russian planes, and when they do fly, they get shot down. Yeah, so imagine getting this kind of air strikes getting as common as Lancers is quite actually it's quite scary. The Makiivka reported fighting, according to Deep State UA. They say that the Russians have partial success again. So, you know, and there is some fighting reported near Gregivka, according to the Russian Defense Ministry. This is very, like I say, Gregivka is a bit far. So just take it with a pinch of salt. I'm not sure how to you know, internalize what that's supposed to mean. Over at the Svetovay front, there is some fighting reported at Stemakivka on the 1st of November. According to the Ukrainian Defense Ministry, they say that they repelled multiple attacks with the Russians trying to push towards Stemakivka. Just let's see how this goes. So, yep, that's it. That's what happened. Over at the Kupiansk front. So, this is Kupiansk. At the Kupiansk front, we have Russians seemingly attacking in multiple directions. We have fighting reported. Okay, let's see. Let me push down. South of Masitivka, south around Sinkivka region or Liman Peshi region, there is fighting reported near Petropolivka. There's fighting reported near Peshotrefnivy. There's Olyansky as well as Ivanivka. So if you look at this in this way, is basically across the entire front line. So yeah, we shall see, because previously it was just, you know, it was just like this. So now, you know, it's becoming a vampire thief. And there is geolocation of Ukrainian forces just off Stepova Novoselivka. Otherwise, the Russian forces are attacking on the 1st and 2nd on the Ivanivka, Olyansky on the 1st, Petrotrefnivy on the 2nd. And then we have fighting reported near Petropolivka on the by the Ukrainian Defense Ministry's report on the 2nd. Sinkivka see fighting on both days, according to the Ukrainian Defense Ministry, and south of Masitivka is according to Deep State UA. The Ukrainians were attacking as well. They were attacking at Sinkivka on 1st to 2nd, and in fact, in the latest report from the Russian Defense Ministry, as per the recording, Zapa group of forces also reported in 2 days, so that's why it's a third, that the Ukrainians 57 separate motorized infantry were attacking. There is fighting reported at Vyshana on the 1st of November, according to Deep State UA. And they say clashes, and based on the last reports of fighting, it's Ukrainian, so I put it Ukrainian, but it could be the Russians. So anyway, this is the Kupiansk run, and this is the SIBREP. Oh wait, I haven't covered some of the shot planes getting shot down. So Ukrainian Sukhoi 27 shot down over Novoselivka, just northwest of Liman. There is Sukhoi 27 shot down over Kuroidivka. I pronounce it as Japanese. Kuroidivka. So Sukhoi 27, let's see how much aircraft is there left with the Ukrainian side, because the Russians keep claiming that they shoot down stuff, but you know, it's getting a bit ridiculous. And then there is a Ukrainian Sukhoi 27 that is destroyed right at the airbase itself, at this Mykhorod or Migorod airbase. So according to the Russian Defense Ministry, they say that one Sukhoi-27 was destroyed at the airbase at the Potova region. So yeah, I wonder what he did, because that's a little bit far from the front lines. And this is the summary for the day of 616 to 617 for the 1st to 2nd of November. The paying members or the DPA sergeants officers will get the access to this report first. So for those that are watching on the delayed telecast on the YouTube DPA War channel or on Rumble, do press the like button, subscribe, and I'll see you in the next update.